The social construction of reality is a core concept in sociology, one that unnerves Christians probably more than any other. What does it mean? The social construction of reality refers to the process whereby people continuously create, through their actions and interactions, a shared reality that is experienced as objectively factual and subjectively meaningful. In other words, the social world is not simply given, it is not natural, it is not revealed, it is not even fully determined. It's made and made up by people. It is transmitted by people. What we have not learned from our own senses, our own intuition, or our own reason, we have learned directly from other human beings. So 95% of what we know, we have simply accepted from what other people have told us. Even what our own senses and intuition and reason tell us is highly shaped by what other people have told us. For example, what counts as reason. The social world could therefore be otherwise. It could be altered. The social reality in which humans live is not inevitable. It is not natural. It can be scary to ponder the possibility that our reality isn't real, but it can also be liberating. We can literally change the world. It can be deconstructed and reconstructed as it has been continuously throughout history. The sociological question is not what is real, nor even how do we know what is real. The sociological question is how does anything come to be accepted as real? And there are three phases to the process. The first is externalization, the process whereby individuals, by their own human activity, create their social worlds. They put what is inside of them out there into social space. Our environment consists of both a physical environment, which we call nature, which is given to humans, and a social environment, which we call culture, which is created by humans. Furthermore, culture can be divided into material culture, our tools and technologies such as axes and microchips, and our non-material culture, which is an abstract order consisting of our beliefs, our values, our norms, etc. Rivers are nature, roads are material culture. But humans can even turn nature into material culture by the meanings we attach to nature, by the uses we make of nature. For example, we can turn rivers into playgrounds, into transportation routes, into disposal dumps, into political boundaries, into sources of hydropower, into sacred spaces, etc. So our total environment consists of nature and culture, and it can be broken down into the following facts. It consists of natural facts like mountains and muskrats. It consists of technological facts such as hammers and highways, institutional facts like money, marriage, normative facts like freedom and fulfillment. Note that these facts constitute increasing levels of dependency. Some facts are dependent on humans and others are not dependent on humans. Mountains are not dependent on human beings at all. Mountains would exist even if humans did not exist. But hammers would not exist if humans did not. Hammers are entirely dependent. They consist of increasing levels of abstraction. Some facts are less physical and more abstract. A hammer has more physicality than money. Some forms of money doesn't even have any physicality at all. It's just debt. It's just in theory. Money can correspond to many things, but a hammer is always only just a hammer. Normative facts have absolutely no physicality whatsoever. There's also an increasing level of meaningfulness. As things become more dependent on us for their existence, they become more meaningful to us. Freedom is more meaningful to us than a hammer, more meaningful to us than money. And finally, there is an imposed order. As things become more dependent, abstract, and meaningful, we impose more order on them. Marriage is more ordered than hammers are. We impose order even where there is none, then create an entire meaning system around that order. For example, skin color is a continuum. We impose the order of race and create racism. Note that because meaning is functionally dependent, abstract, and ordered, it is contingent and precarious. It can be changed because it's not attached to anything. It's a whim of history. Why are people willing to kill or die for meanings such as religion? Why? Because it does not come to us as contingent or precarious or unstable. It is presented to us as a hard reality through the process of objectivation. Precarious meaning must be made to appear stable, unquestionable, taken for granted. Externalizations, that which we humans externalize, are made into objective reality that has consequences for us because it acts back on us. It coerces its creators. Objectivation is the process whereby individuals apprehend everyday life as an ordered, prearranged reality that imposes itself upon but is seemingly independent of human beings. How is that possible? Well, that's a result of four things. Institutionalization occurs when meaningful behaviors become routinized or habitual. Historicity, as generations come and go, the institutional world thickens and hardens. Legitimation, meaning is all meanings are given either a cognitive or a moral basis that will explain and justify the meaning. And the most powerful form of legitimation, one of many kinds, but probably the most powerful form, is religion. To say that God says legitimates it stronger than any other legitimation that we have. So, for example, religion places the source of meaning beyond the human realm as a given eternal truth to be discovered, not just an optional belief that was created. Religion defines deviance as evil, not just alternative. It allows us to threaten deviance with eternal damnation. Religion enables people to feel an ultimate sense of righteousness. It dissolves all our doubts about the correctness of our behaviors and our feelings. And religion integrates all of life by making sense of everything. Fourthly, the fourth form of legitimation is of objectivation is language. Meaning becomes embedded in language. Language exists outside of each one of us, therefore it's an objective social entity. Third phase, internalization, the process whereby individuals learn the legitimations of the institutional order. We carry culture around in our heads. We let culture define who we are. And so, reality is socially constructed. Here's a summary. Society is a human product, externalization. Society is an objective reality, objectivation. And humans are a social product. One other concept, reification, big bite. Reification is the apprehension of the products of human activity as if they were something other than human products, such as facts of nature or results of cosmic laws or a manifestation of divine will. Reification implies that humans are capable of forgetting their own authorship of the human world, and further that the dialectic between humans, the producers, and their products is lost to consciousness. In other words, the humanly made world is explained in terms that deny its human production. Three types of realities, based on its reality's verifiability, objective versus subjective, and its dependency on the human mind, independent or dependent. Natural realities are independent and objective. They are not dependent on human mental activities. All the physical facts of the universe exist in reality independent of any human activity. And they enable us to form some knowledge of reality beyond our social constructions. We learn that we cannot fly, at least not without the machines that we construct that enable us to fly. Personal realities are dependent and subjective. Beliefs held by persons that are real to those who hold them, but that have not been socially institutionalized. In other words, they are mentally dependent because their existence depends on human cognitions. But they're also subjective because they exist only in the minds of those who hold them, such as someone's belief that they can actually fly. Social realities are dependent and objective. Beliefs that are shared and have been institutionalized via externalization, objectivation, and internalization. All of culture, non-material culture, material culture, are social realities. Other realities, independent of the human mind and subjective, cannot be known. They can be postulated. But as soon as they are postulated, they immediately become mind-dependent and social. So concepts of the supernatural or the superpersonal or the super-social, concepts of God. All human knowledge is conceptually mediated and influenced by sociocultural factors. We enculturate even rivers. We turn rivers into culture. But three dimensions of reality are entirely socially constructed: technological, institutional, and normative facts. Humans construct roads, not rivers, but we construct the meanings of rivers, even if not the rivers themselves. Conclusions. Practical embodied activity in the material world is part of human knowing and being. Some human existence cannot be reduced to cognition or to language or to socially constructed knowledge. The need to eat, the need to breathe, the need to avoid defying gravity is knowledge that we derive directly from nature. People do not live only in a world of ideas or concepts or meanings. As Kundera said, "I think, therefore I am," is the statement of an intellectual who underrates toothaches. Humans do not socially construct all reality, but rather primarily their beliefs about reality. Beliefs are not substitutes for the things that beliefs are about, such as what a toothache means. And it comes down to the physical nature given by God compared to the social culture constructed by humans. So, perhaps the best conclusion is to say the social construction of social reality, the technological, the institutional, the normative. Francis Bacon's notion of two books remains helpful. God's world, the general revelation, is given directly to humans by God. God's word is a special revelation given indirectly to humans by God, but through other humans. And to that extent is socially constructed. And that's why some trust God's world more than God's word, because they trust the messages in divinely constructed physical nature more than the messages in humanly constructed texts. I've given only a brief description of the social construction of reality, not an evaluation or critique of it. For that, you should take social science and Christianity, pardon the plug. Final question, is God a mind independent objective fact or a mind dependent social construction? My beliefs about God are clearly social constructions. My faith is that the reality of God lies beyond those constructions. Thank you.